we put that tiny clip to speak on Lenin a month ago because he's sort of doing meetings all over the place, so I'm very pleased to have him here tonight. And I'm hoping that in three quarters of an hour he can proceed down his five readings of the complete works of Lenin.
Ah, you're lucky if I read it only five times. No, actually, the problem really with Lenin is that I want to relate Lenin to today's struggle. And I'll start by saying the basic difference between Lenin and Marx is that Marx lived in the period that capitalism was still expanding. And therefore, the main work of Marx really is in the form of analysis. The main contribution of Marx is the theoretical contribution of Marx. The organization contribution of Marx is relatively very, very small. In a whole period of 40 long years of struggle, he belonged to an organization for a very short time. The thing that is characteristic for Lenin is the actuality, the immediacy of revolution. I mean, the thing in the biography of Lenin, the simple fact that at the age of 17, when Lenin didn't know anything about revolution, never heard of revolution to speak of, never heard the name Marx, his brother was already hanged. You know, in other words, the idea of revolution was in the air from the time that Lenin was practically born. It was always there. And the actuality of revolution is central, the first thing when you speak about Lenin. And this is basic difference between Lenin and Marx. That emphasized with Lenin is really the guide to action. That Marxism is a guide to action. When people tell you that Marxism is a science, of course Marxism is a science. But there is a difference between a science and an art. There is a difference. For example, the law of gravity of Newton. This is science. According to the law of Newton, if you drop a stone or you drop a piece of paper, the law of gravity is the same law of gravity. It falls the same speed. Now, if you use this law of gravity for throwing stones or throwing pieces of paper at the head of a policeman, you'll find it is different. One of them moves quickly, one of them moves slowly. And therefore, you can't, by learning Newton from now to eternity, you'll never know how to throw stones. Here is where practice makes perfect. You see, this is the problem that between Marxism as a theory, as a science, and Marxism as an art, Marxism as a guide to action, there is a jump. Not that one doesn't lead to the other, one does lead to the other. But there is a jump. I mean, you can know, for example, grammar and syntax beautifully. You can sit for the rest of your life, learn grammar and syntax. Still, to be a poet, you need to know not only grammar and syntax, but something more. This is the jump from science to art. And for Lenin, when you speak about Lenin, you have to speak about Lenin not only as a scientist of the revolution, but also the artist of the revolution, because otherwise you don't understand Lenin at all. You don't. In other words, when you look even the style life of Lenin and the style life of Marx, if you see the pictures of Marx, you know, the clothes of Marx and the clothes of Lenin are so different. Very, very different. You can see Lenin is the practical man that has to move around. And then he looks like anybody in the street at the time. You look at his style of writing. Terribly interesting. Now, Marx is beautiful. Marx is grand. But to be honest, Marx is very, very difficult to read. To read Lenin, especially Lenin when he writes for the Russian workers, man, that's the simplest thing in the world. It is so simple that everybody can understand it. I mean, the story goes that once Lenin fixed a meeting with Clara Zetkin. Clara Zetkin was a great German revolutionary. She phoned him, and she fixed a meeting with him. She never met him before. She came to the place, and she saw an old man sitting. So she sat with him and started talking. After half an hour, she looked at the watch and said, "Where is Lenin?" This old man said to her, "I am Lenin." She said, "You are Lenin? You're speaking more simply than any councillor in Germany. Local councillor will do." She said, "I'm not a local councillor, I'm not a bourgeois councillor, I'm a revolutionary communist." You see, now this is, if you read a sentence from Marx, I can tell you straight, don't tell me who wrote it. Don't tell me, cover the name, I'll tell you it is Marx. If you look at Lenin, you say, "My good God, is that Lenin?" I mean, quite often his speeches end, "If we want to do the right things, we should do that." And he sits down. Or he says, "This is the way to do it." Or, "We should continue on this road." It is extremely simple. The beautiful simple. the way he writes, because he's really relating to immediacy of the struggle. This is really the great thing about Lenin. I mean, we come to the central things about Lenin. The first thing about Lenin is very, very important. When Marx said the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class, so Lenin draws one simple lesson from it. That you have to look for inspiration, for innovation, for the capacity of struggle in the working class. You don't look for it anywhere else. Because there are many people, I've met, because I've been in the movement a few years, you know, I met many, many people that will repeat 50 times in one, the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class. But when they decide a strategy on tactics, you have a feeling they sit in a room and they have a big books, lots and lots of books, and they look at the books to find the strategy. Man, this is not if the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class. Above all, you have to learn from the struggle of the working class as reflected in the real world and as it reflected in books or pamphlets that are also a reflection of the struggle of the working class. This is the reason when you look at Lenin's writing, the main source of inspiration is always coming from the class. And I'll give you two, in my eyes, two very beautiful examples. I'll give you one example. It is July 1917. And I'll tell you what it is, July 1917. There are 400,000 workers in St. Petersburg, or Petrograd, whatever you want to call it, marching on the 4th of July. 400,000 workers and soldiers marching in the streets. They are armed. They want to smash the government of the time, the Kerensky government. The Bolshevik Party and Lenin, as the leader of the party, are against immediate confrontation with the government. They say, yes, we have majority in this town, in this city, but we don't have majority in Moscow, we don't have majority in other towns, we need still a few weeks of patient explanation. You see, the period of revolution, few weeks is like decades in our lifetime. And therefore, Lenin was against immediate confrontation. This was July the 4th. On July the 5th, therefore, the demonstration ended. And the workers went back to work, and the soldiers went back to the army camps. Then the government goes on offensive. The Bolshevik Party is declared illegal. The party paper is smashed. The party print shop is smashed. Lenin is accused of being a German spy. Lenin, the Bolsheviks. Lenin goes into hiding. Trotsky is arrested, is in prison. This is the situation after the July the 4th. And Lenin, a week ago afterwards, writes a very small paragraph, a beautiful story. He says, I was sitting there and eating bread with the worker that he was hiding at his place. While I was eating bread, this worker said, the bread is good. They don't dare to give us rotten bread. And Lenin writes about it. He says, for nights I couldn't sleep. I couldn't make up my mind. Has counter-revolution been victorious on July the 5th? Or only reaction has been victorious? You see, the difference between counter-revolution and reaction is this. If there is a revolution, a rising wave of revolutionary struggle, counter-revolution means complete decline, a turning point in this general trend. Reaction is simply a little retreat on the general trend that still continues upwards. And therefore, for Lenin, it was very, very important to know whether the reaction victorious. I mean, in English, the two words are more or less the same, so I want to make it clear the way Lenin understood the two words. Reaction means the revolution was still continuing, but there was a little bit of defeat for the revolutionary forces. Counter-revolution victorious means complete decline of the revolutionary forces. And Lenin says, here I am, intellectual, sitting, thinking, using books to find out whether counter-revolution victorious or only reaction. And this worker told me the truth. They are frightened of us. They are giving us good bread. Now this is a fantastic capacity of understanding the psychology of workers, of millions of workers. From one worker told him about bread. Now I am not suggesting that any one of us, once we leave this meeting, should rush to the restaurant next door and ask for bread and ask the waiter what does he think of the bread. This will not teach you anything in British conditions. Perhaps that's not the way of measuring the temperature, the psychology of workers at the present situation. Perhaps the question of bread is not the question you have to ask. Perhaps there is another question you have to ask. But this is terribly exciting, terribly interesting. One example, how Lenin learns from one worker, not millions of them, one worker, with one comment, because I'm ready to bet there were thousands of Marxists at the time. The party in July 1917 in St. Petersburg alone had 50,000 members. So in this city there were 50,000 party members that ate bread, and 50,000 party members heard the same words more or less, the bread is better. They knew that the bread is better, but they didn't draw the conclusion. The government is frightened of us. In other words, it was reaction. But still the revolution forces are intact. You see, the whole strategy, tactics of Lenin at the time, those few days, are decided by this beautiful sentence. The bread is good, but still frightened of us. I'll give you another example. It is 1905. Lenin is here in London, actually. And he comes to his room, and in his room he sees a priest and a student. The priest is Father Gapon. Father Gapon was a police agent, but Lenin didn't know it. And a priest, and there is a party, a Bolshevik student, sits and reads the party program. You know, he reads it to Gapon. And all the time Gapon says, yes, yes. Until one sentence, and Gapon says no. And I'll tell you what the sentence is. You see, Lenin was the expert on the land question in Russia, on the agrarian question. And the agrarian question in Russia is the most important, because there were millions of peasants. Now, Lenin wrote the agrarian program of the Socialist Party, Socialist Movement in Russia. And Lenin was the expert, par excellence. He wrote the program. And what did he write in the program? He wrote in the program the following: that those pieces of land that were robbed from the peasant in 1861, when the serfs were freed, those pieces of land, and a very important piece of land, should be returned to the peasant. This was the program that Lenin wrote and for years repeated. The last time in the program of 1903. And here the priest reads it, somebody reads it actually to the priest, and the priest says, no, all the land. The peasant should have all the land, not only the land that was taken from them, but all the land. And Krupskaya, in her memoirs, his widow, or his wife, you know, at that time his wife, of course, Lenin's wife, in her memoirs, writes, Lenin left the house. And after many, many hours, he came back. And he says, Gapon is right. All the land. And the party program was changed. Now you ask yourself the following. If any one of us came to a room and found a priest, what you would have said to him? Go to hell, to another place. Second of all, who the hell will read your party program? And if you read the party program and this priest has a comment, who the hell wants to listen to a comment of an idiotic priest? But because this priest was a priest working among the workers of St. Petersburg, and those workers of St. Petersburg had roots in the villages, because hundreds of thousands of them came from the villages. They were first generation workers. Therefore Lenin listened to this man and said, man, it clicks. You see, now this is magnificent. The feel of how you react to the working class on psychology, on feeling. Even if it goes third degree, third wave with a priest that is a police agent at the same time. Now, going from that, you must understand, Lenin was away, practically all his life away from Russia. All his other life he was away, either in Switzerland, or in Britain, or in France, or in Austria. He was everywhere, but not in Russia, for years. And you say, under such conditions, how the hell he had his fingers on the pulse? And he had his fingers on the pulse. He had his fingers on the pulse, fantastically well he had his fingers on the pulse. The first reason, because he really knew that the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class. For him it was not abstraction. It was not millions of workers in the abstract. It was Ivan Ivanovich. It was the individual worker that is part of the class, rooted in the class, from whom you have to learn. And this was the first thing we have to understand about Lenin. That he really, when Marx said the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class, Lenin meant, quite simply, we have to look to the working class in order to learn from them. And I'll give you the third example to make it absolutely clear. In 1905, the Soviet was established. the first Soviet in the world, the St. Petersburg Soviet. Originally it started in Congress, perhaps think the Soviet was established in order to take power. That's what people think. Or it was established in order to make a revolution. Nothing of the sort. The original Soviet was simply a delegation from different print shops. Because the printers were paid for letters, but they were not paid for punctuations. When they were setting by hand, not the way we are doing it now, more modern one, they were not paid for question mark, full stop, comma, brackets, exclamation mark. And they wanted to be paid for those punctuation marks. And in order to be paid, they sent delegates to one place and said, we want to fight as a united organization of printers. It developed into a Soviet of the whole city, the Soviet of St. Petersburg. Now, it's very interesting the reaction of Marxists to the idea of the Soviets. The local branch committee of the Bolshevik Party in St. Petersburg sent delegation to this Soviet and said to them the following. Either you accept our leadership or we are withdrawing. Just like that, they put the ultimatum. Then they say, well, the other one said, the devil knows who needs such an organization. We have the party. What the hell do we need the Soviets for? This was the reaction. The interesting Lenin's reaction. His immediate reaction was, the devil knows. That's what Krupsky described. The devil knows what it is. He didn't know what it is. But 3 days later, he wrote one of the most magnificent writing I've ever read. But you must understand, it is not impressive if you think about it in 1974. It is terribly impressive if it is a news phenomenon in September 1905, not now, that never existed before, and started not by Bolsheviks. If anybody did start it, it was the right-wing Mensheviks and other Mensheviks that were involved in it. It wasn't the Bolsheviks that started it. You know what Lenin's reaction to it? It's very interesting. He says, marvelous kind of organization is the Soviet. It is democratic, because it is rooted in the factory, delegates from the factories. It is centralistic, because it comes to one center. And therefore he says, this Soviet is the form of organization of the struggle of the worker, of the workers. And this form is the form of the workers' government of the future. Now you see, this is magnificent. This is magnificent because you know what it really means. Those workers only started it. Now, many Marxists wouldn't have looked at it. But because Lenin really believed that the main thing is the inspiration that comes from the working class, that you have to learn from the working class, he says, all right, let's look at this Soviet, how marvelous it is. I'm giving you examples so that the idea will be again and again hammered into our heads. Because the picture that we get from Moscow about what Lenin looked like, Lenin looked in Moscow like somebody sitting there somewhere at the top of the mountain, seeing everything, knowing everything, creating everything, like the image of God. And that's why when you read the biographies of Lenin, it makes you vomit when you read really the Russian published biographies. Because they describe him, first of all, a son of a father, progressive educator. All this is rubbish. His father was a religious reactionary man that got the nobility from the Tsar. He got twice rise in the hierarchy at the period of the worst reaction in the educational field. This is the truth. There's nothing wrong with it, for heaven's sake. There's no reason at all why a poet, his father would be a poet. There's no reason at all why Karl Marx's father wouldn't have been some miserable middle-class rubbish. There's no reason at all. But the way they describe it, they want to describe the immaculate conception of Lenin. Lenin out of nowhere, out of this, comes from everything is created. And the party, I'll tell you what the party, the tactics, I'll tell you what they come. They come out of the head of Lenin, like in the legends, you know, I don't know, Minerva came out of the head of Zeus. In the religion it comes like that. In the real world, Lenin was completely different. And this is really impressive about him, that he was in the fight and grew in the fight. And Lenin of 1870 is not Lenin of 1917 or 1922. He's not the same man. He grew in the struggle because he knew where the inspiration comes from. Now again, but speaking about inspiration in the working class, confidence in the working class, it also means that one simple thing. That when Lenin speaks about the party, and Lenin wrote a lot about the party, because he says quite simply, the workers are like a steam. The workers' struggle is like a steam. But you need to direct it, and that's why you need a piston. And the party is the piston. The party is the locomotive. Steam by itself is nothing. Because steam will produce nothing. But I'll tell you a secret. Locomotive by itself will produce nothing. And the combination of the two is the thing that really matters. But the idea that the party without the class means nothing means that in the real world, every time Lenin said, let's measure the party in terms of the class. I'll give you a simple example. Lenin in 1902 wrote a lovely little book that I hope many of you will read, called What is to be Done? And the idea of what is to be done basically is summed up with the following sentences. The workers struggle, but they struggle locally. The horizon is the local horizon. Because it is a local horizon, it is a narrow horizon. Because of that, it is distorted. In British terms, for example, it means you can be a very good militant in Coventry, in a factory floor, and you can be still a racialist. Because the horizon is simply of the floor. So in the shop floor, you again hate the boss. Because you see the boss, and the boss is a white man, you will never dream to come to the boss and say, hey, bossy, you and me are one nation, one race, what about the fiver? You know, from experience, that's not a way of getting money. You have to bang on the table. I can't do it on this table. It is unstable. You have to bang on the table to demand the money. You know that. But when it comes to the national interest, that's a different story. Who the hell saw the nation? I want to see anybody in this room to ever met the British nation. You never met him. Have you ever met the British capitalist class? Of course not. You met your boss, but you didn't meet the boss class. You met your workmates. You didn't meet the working class. And therefore, consciousness can be split consciousness. You can be militant in terms of the factory. And you can be racialist in the terms of the nation. It can be done. And therefore, Lenin in 1902 says, what is necessary to go beyond the immediate experience? That's why we need a party that connects all the experience of the class. And this party must be made under illegal condition of professional revolutionaries, and therefore party members are people that live for the party, die for the party, paid practically by the party, because they have to move all the time. Of the nature of the illegal conditions. This was right in 1902. In 1905, in a congress in London, there is a fifth congress of the Bolshevik Party. Actually, they didn't call it called the Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party, Bolsheviks. They met in London in May 1905. And Lenin says, we have only 6,000 party members in St. Petersburg. That's disgusting. Open the doors. We need 10 times more members. And it's very interesting. The Congress of the party voted against Lenin's resolution. Lenin was beaten on this issue, by the way. And you know how they beat him? By quoting him what he says in 1902. What is to be done? One after another, they got up and said, look, but what is to be done that you wrote says exactly the opposite. So he says, yes, comrades, but you see the struggle, the party has to relate to the struggle. We are at the middle of the revolution. There are now hundreds of thousands of workers in the battle. We don't need a group of professional revolutions. We ought to open the gates of the party. You see, what I'm trying to say, that for him, the party was not an abstraction. The party was always related to the class. And one of the most magnificent things is the days of 1917. If you read what happened in 1917. Because the party, he created the party. He knew how to create a machine. And the machine is very, very important. But you knew how also to smash the machine. Because in 1917, you find the same party become backward. Why it became backward? Obviously, because they saw a custom in certain methods of struggle. That come 1917, and you find that Lenin on the question of the October Revolution, don't call it the October Revolution, but the question of the revolution, was in a minority. You find that when he came to Russia on the 3rd of April 1917, and they welcomed him in the Finland station, perhaps you read it in books or you saw it in films, Lenin comes to the Finland station, and there are tens of thousands of soldiers and workers welcoming Lenin. And there is the chairman of the Soviet, Chekhaidze, leader of the Menshevik Party, the chairman of the St. Petersburg Soviet, comes to him and says, Comrade Lenin, first of all, somebody called on Tai, a woman brought him a flower, a big bunch of flowers, and Lenin was absolutely embarrassed with the flowers because it looked so bloody incongruous in the middle of a revolution to have this big bunch of flowers. So the description how he put the flowers aside And when Chizya said to him, in the name of the victorious Russian Revolution, we welcome you, Comrade Lenin, and we hope that you will side with the victorious Russian Revolution. Lenin turns his back on him, turns to the workers and the soldiers, and says, what victorious Russian Revolution? You got rid of the Tsar? So what? They did it in France 130 years ago. What revolution? The capitalists are still there, the landlords are still there, the war is still there. Down with the provisional government, all power to the Soviets, down with the imperialist war. Now, the interesting thing, the description, there is a chap called Sukhanov that wrote his memoirs of the time, when he described how the party leaders were baffled. Not the Mensheviks, they were, this is nothing. The Bolshevik leaders were absolutely astonished. They thought he's mad. Next day, there was a short report about his speech in Pravda, in the Bolshevik paper, with a note written by the editor. Comrade Lenin is out of touch. Comrade Lenin doesn't understand the situation. And you see, it's not an accident that in April 1917, Lenin was alone. Next day, when he writes his famous April thesis that sums up clearly what is to be done, to overthrow the government, to give the power to the Soviets, to divide the land among the peasants, to establish workers' control in the factory, to declare straight fraternization in the trenches with the German soldiers. When this is published, he cannot find another party leader to sign it with him. It is signed by one man from the Central Committee, Lenin. Nobody supported him. Now you say to yourself, how did the hell did Lenin manage to win the party? And I'll tell you how he managed to win the party. He said, as he repeats again and again in his letters at the time, if the Central Committee doesn't support me, I'll go to the sailors. And he meant it. He meant it. And quite, as a matter of fact, the amount of breaking the discipline of the party that Lenin did at that time is many absolutely astonishing. Because he writes to individual district committees. He writes to the district committee of Vyborg, for example, and say, distribute the following statement. And they do distribute. Down the provisional government. It's against the Central Committee decision. And you know why? Because of course you need the machine. Of course you need the party to lead the class. But you need the party has to lead the class. It is not that the party is the omnipotent, self-sufficient, God knows what. And therefore one of the beautiful things that I did, in my, I wrote a book on Leninism. I wrote 3 volumes as a matter of fact. But in the first volume, I quote 2 people writing on the same subject. I'll tell you who they are. Lenin and Stalin, on the Bloody Sunday, 1905. You know what Bloody Sunday was? It was a massive demonstration of 200,000 workers in which the police opened guns on them and a few hundred dead. Now, next day, Lenin writes a leaflet, Stalin writes a leaflet. It's very interesting to compare the leaflets. Lenin writes, I never bring quotation with me because it takes too much time really to find them. My memory is very, very good because I read it. 70 times, if you want to know the book, but I was very, very careful to understand it, to try to understand it. He writes, the anger of the Russian workers, the anger and the hate and the enthusiasm should smash Tsarism. Very good. He speaks about the workers. Stalin writes a leaflet. Under the leadership of the party committees, forward to the promised land. This is the word he used, forward to the promised land. Under the leadership of the party committees. You know what they emphasize in the 2 cases? First of all, we, the committee, will lead you. Second of all, we'll tell you where is the promised land. Not that you, blooming in your anger and activity, will create whatever it is, the future. If you want to call it promised land, I don't care if it's a religious term, really, to be honest. Because somebody promises you, not something that you gain through your own struggle. And therefore, even in 1905, you can see the difference between Lenin, there is a fantastic respect to the workers in struggle, and between the party committee that simply says, the party comes first, and to hell with the rest. Of course the party is important, but the party is important only in relation to the struggle of the class. And I want to move on from that. I want to explain a few other things about Lenin. You see, people generally, when they speak about Lenin, they always think about the romantic aspect. You know, because in the book it is easy to do it. You know, you say, in 1887, the Lenin brother was hanged. impressive. Then you jump a few years and you have some other event. Then you jump another page and there's 1905. Then you jump another page and there's 1917. All big, romantic, marvelous things. But you know the truth? If the emancipation of the working class is the act of the working class, then you have to find the revolutionary leader, not only the summit in the mountain, but also in the valleys. Also when the things are hard and horrible and grinding and petty. And one of the best chunks of Lenin's life, believe it or not, and for us perhaps more important, because we are, at the present minute, I mean, not generally, is that when you describe Lenin's action at the period of the small deeds, at the period that marvelous things not happen, there are no barricades, there are no general strikes, there are no Soviets, there practically nothing exists. There are small battles practically about nothing. And I'll give you only two examples. One of them, sickness benefits, and the other one, the paper. Sickness benefit is very, very important. I'll tell you what is very important. In 1912, the Tsar, or the Home Secretary, actually, the Secretary of the Minister of the Interior, as he was called, established sickness funds in Russia. I'll tell you what they were a very small thing. If you are in a factory, you collect every week, you give a couple of kopecks. A kopeck means something like a penny in British terms, you know. You give a couple of kopecks and they are put in a fund, right? And every factory has a sickness fund. Is it exciting? You say, my good God, it must be absolutely boring. Who cares about the sickness fund? Now Lenin is so straight away in it. He said, you know what is exciting about the sickness fund? Every worker gives money to the sickness fund, right? It is centralized in the factory, right? So let's fight about control of the sickness funds in the factory. Now let's connect the different sickness funds of different factories. Isn't that a good idea? Let's create a federation of sickness funds. Then, if there is a federation, they need a paper. And he started a monthly paper for sickness funds. And in a very, very short time, they create a net that covered 2 million workers in the sickness fund. And then from that he went, from this paper, the monthly paper for the sickness fund, continued to be published legally. It was a legal paper, once a month. And you say, if you are a reformist, what do you think you write in the sickness fund? I'll tell you what you write. You'll write, we pay 2 kopecks and we get a ruble. Why don't we pay only 1.5 kopecks and get 1.5 rubles? Or whatever it is. You deal only with the money. A little bit less money to give, a little bit more money to receive. Now Lenin is much better than that. He writes about those technical things of a little bit more money to give, a little bit more money to receive, or less money to give, more money to receive. But much more important, he writes on the political issues that are involved. And I'll give you an example. When the war breaks out, 1914 war breaks out, what does he write? He writes the editorial, not under his name, of course. It's a legal paper, so he can't write it under his name. And he starts by saying this. Sickness funds are very, very important. All those rubles are very, very important. All those kopecks are very, very important. But because of a war that raises the cost of living not by single kopecks and single rubles, but by tens of rubles, a war on which the Russian people were not involved and were not asked whether they want it or not, that's why our sickness funds are not as effective as they should have been. That's all what Lenin writes on the sickness fund. But you know, that's a declaration of opposition to the war. Around a tiny thing, really, as the sickness fund. And if you want to know the truth, the Bolshevik party, when they established themselves as mass party, they established themselves very much around the sickness fund. Because in 1912, the party had only 1,000 members, a remnant of the party of 1905. And they had to build party from nothing. And they built it through the sickness fund. Again, he used, I'll give you three examples. He used another thing besides the sickness fund, a thing called the Duma. You know, in Britain, you have a parliament, right? In the parliament, you know, the one man, one vote, and all the rest of it. In Russia, the Duma was only consultative parliament. You know, they didn't decide who are the ministers. They couldn't remove the ministers. The ministers were appointed by the king, by the Tsar. But they could consult. It is much less important, you say. Of course it is less important. Again, there was also one man, one vote, because the nobility was allowed 300 seats, and the workers were allowed 13 seats. Therefore, you say, my good God, why should Lenin bother about a miserable institution that has no power, that the nobility he built in 300 seats, and we, the workers, are allowed only 13 seats. And Lenin says quite simply, if you want to use a platform, use any dung heap to stand on. And he used it beautifully, the Duma. This is the day of the small deeds. I'm giving an example from the small deeds. The third example of the small deeds is the example of the Pravda. In April 1912, there is a strike in Elena Gold Mines. Elena Gold Mines is thousands of miles, I forgot how many miles, 4,000 or 5,000 miles away from St. Petersburg, very, very far away. In Siberia, there are a few hundred workers killed and wounded in this strike. There is fantastic excitement in Russia because of this murder of workers and massive spontaneous demonstration. Lenin, a fortnight after the Elena massacre, started the daily, but a different kind of a daily that never existed in Russia before and never existed in Britain, as a matter of fact. I don't know a daily like that, to be honest. Because I'll tell you what he did. He said, we have only 1,000 party members. How do you start a daily with 1,000 party members? He said, I'll tell you what. Let's make the workers the writers, let's make the workers the sellers, let the workers pay for the paper. And in a very short time, he created 5,000 party groups in the factories. Not party members, let's be clear about it. They're not simply, because from 1,000 you can't build 5,000 groups just like that. He simply said, if any group of workers want this paper, let them collect together to get the paper, and if they want to give donation, let them give donation of a kopeck a week on their payday. It's like a penny a week, that's very little. You know, perhaps in that terms it was more because standard of living was low, but it is still only a few pennies. Let them give it. Let them give you the donation, let them sell the paper, and let them write for the paper. In the first year that the paper existed, he got 11,000 articles and reports from workers. Now this is magnificent. Under illegal conditions, and with the working class half literate, with the whole working class make only 3 million, to get such a paper, of course there was a revolutionary struggle. You can't create it out of nothing. But this was a magnificent achievement, understanding the small deal. And to be honest, he was very, very clever how he did it. Because the party was illegal, the paper was legal. And how you combine them, I mean, there are a few tricks that they did. For example, if you are the editor of the paper, you are arrested if the government doesn't like you. So you find that in the first year, the editors of the paper sat in prison 47 and a half months. Now you say it is impossible in 1 year to be 47 and a half months in prison. It is possible. Because if you are the editor, you get 3 months. Then there's another editor, he gets another 3 months. Then the cumulative number of months in 1 year was 47 and a half months in prison. Not only this, it was printed legally. And the law says that if you are printing anything, you have to show 3 copies to the censor. So the censor will say, is it all right or isn't it all right? That's the censorship, the government, the police censorship. But they didn't tell you how to deliver the 3 copies. So what did the Bolsheviks do? The print shop was one place, the censorship was another part in St. Petersburg, very far away. They didn't say how to deliver the copies. So they found an old man of 70, a little bit more than 70, and he every day will take the 3 copies and walk. You can imagine how long it took him. It took him 3 hours to walk from the print shop until the censor. When, in the meantime, of course, the print shop is printing, and by the way, their machines were not as good as ours. It was very slow. But still, they managed in those 3 hours to print 40 or 50,000 copies. He came there to the censor and said, now when he saw the censor, because it's an old man, he has to rest, and he looked at the censor. Now when the censor looked at the letter and the paper and moved to another paper, then the old man got up quietly and walked home. But if he saw that this censor is going to phone the police, he was going to see the telephone, this old man suddenly was not as old as all that, jumped out, jumped into the carriage, and quickly rushed to the print shop. And on top of the print shop, there was always people looking out, so that when they saw them, the man coming, straight away, they hid the copies. And the police, for good 2 years, never managed to collect more than 300 or 400 copies of the paper. Well, the paper was printed daily, every day. Now this is the period of the small deeds. And to be honest, we must understand that to speak about the working class, leading the working class, learning from the working class, is not only learning in a big scale, Soviets and all those very important things, but also in a small scale. in a small scale of credibility about sickness funds and about the miserable Duma, about how to run a workers' paper, etc., etc., etc. All those things are very great inspiration because we can learn from them. I mean, not sickness funds because there's not the same setup in Britain. The problems are different, but still, we can learn very much from them. The last point I want to refer to Lenin and Lenin and the state. You see, when you speak about the revolution, many people speak about revolution, to be honest. But to 90% of British Marxists, when they speak about revolution, they never have the feel that revolution means insurrection. That revolution means about physical military power, about arms, about physical strength. I mean, for example, when we criticize the Labour government, I heard many people speaking about the Labour government, the present Labour government or the old Labour government. They attack the Labour government quite rightly that they don't give enough to the old age pensioners, rightly. They attack the government because of the income policy. They attack the government about many, many things. You know, the small, simple thing that I would have asked in the terms of the leader of Lenin from this government is a very simple one. Are they going to abolish the SAS? Is Harold Wilson going to abolish the special branch? Is Harold Wilson going to abolish the tapping of telephones? Is Harold Wilson going to have open the secrets of the CID of Scotland Yard? You see, that it's very interesting. When Lenin speaks about the state, it's exactly that. He says, smash the state machine, smash the secret police, open their archives. You know, and when he opened the archive, he had the shock of his life because he found that from seven committee members of St. Petersburg, three were police agents. He found that the editor of Pravda was a police agent and the business manager of Pravda was police agent. He found a few other shocking things. I'm not suggesting, by the way, any insinuation that with our district in London are any police agents. But still, I hear opening the secret, smashing the state machine. This is what the revolution is all about. And this is the thing that is terribly relevant today. When you speak about Chile, what is Chile about? What is the lesson of Chile? It's about the state machine. Can you trust the army? Can workers trust the police? Is it the question the same man that taps my telephone at present? When the revolution comes, he'll stop tapping my telephone and he'll tap your telephone. Is that what the revolution is all about? Or you have to bloody smash the bastard so he can't tap the telephones. And on smashing him, you have to go into Scotland Yard to open the archives and find exactly how the tapping is being done. To find the names, to find the list, to find all the rest of it. And that's what really the smashing the state means. And therefore, for Lenin, when Lenin says that the revolution above all is a struggle for power, that for to be a Marxist is to struggle for workers' power, this is exactly what it means. That you have to smash the army and the police, you have to smash the state institution, you have to smash the judiciary, you know, the court, etc., and establish instead of this what? The armed workers as keeping order, the armed workers as defending themselves, the armed workers, no bureaucracy, no standing army, and bureaucracy is not words. Bureaucracy is anybody that is independent from you, that gets better conditions than you, that gets more money than you, that you don't elect and you can't recall. And therefore for Lenin, and this is the heart really of Leninism in the finances, the height of Leninism, is the question of the state. They have to smash the state and establish workers' councils. This is again an idea that Lenin learned from 1905, the Soviet of St. Petersburg, but he developed it much further than that. And therefore everything I said about Lenin, I think, is fantastically relevant to us. Of course with adaptation to British condition, the condition of 1974, not to the condition of 1917. That's all comments.